Hello all. I'm so happy to be here and I'm so happy to talk to you on one of the topics that I feel so dearly about. During the daytime, I'm a robotics engineer, and during the evening, I think about building new cities. This has been my obsession for nearly two decades now. So in this, we are going to be talking about something that is fundamentally needed for India. How are we going to build a drastically great amount of new cities for us to get to the state that we want? So look here, there are two Indias. One India on the left side, that was in the around 2000 BCE, when our civilization was at its height, when the Harappan and the Mohenjo-daro civilization was the leading civilization of its time. And it was we invented urban planning in a sense. So we had, for instance, a drainage systems, a properly planned road systems, proper standards, and all those things. This I'm talking about 4,000 years ago. Now, 4,000 years later, when we should have, like, you know, gone much, much, much further in, you know, urban development planning and so on. Where are we? So our urban centers are like such a filthy mess. So if our ancestors, like from Lothal and other places, 4,000 years ago, if they come back, they'd be wondering, like, you know, what went wrong? Like, well, what happened? Like, you know, we had invented all those things. Like, why did you guys not follow those things? That would be something that they'd be wondering. Now, so it is time to get back to, like, the Indian mode. It is the Indian mode is the one that built this thing. We have to be building that great cities once again, because civilization comes from the word city. It is cities that are the core for our whole civilization. So look at the urbanization rate by country. So here you can see, like, the top countries, whether it is like Israel or Sweden, or to some extent even the US, the urbanization is really, really high. So the only the rich can afford to stay in a village. So in India, it's a complete opposite. So there is a lot of us are forced to be in the village. So here the rich sort of live in the cities and poor live in the village, contrary to the places over here. And this is also correlated with a lot of other good indicators. So the countries that lead in urbanization also have better healthcare indicators, better socioeconomic indicators overall. And India is almost close to the bottom of that scale. So a civilization, a country that invented urban planning, that was among the most urbanized civilizations in the world, we are among the least urbanized. And in parallel to that, we have so many other indicators that got screwed up. So this is where, like, you know, what happened to all these great cities, whether it is Harappa, Mohenjo-daro, and Rakhigarhi, and Lothal of the Indus Valley civilization, or the cities that came after, like the Kashi, Kanchi, like, you know, Sirka, Dwarka, Kumbhar, so many of these great cities. Some of these cities still live as a shadow of their past greatness. Majority of them are gone. Like, you know, we had to wait for some railway engineers, British railway engineers, to find out the great greatness of the Indus Valley civilization. A lot of our great cities have gone. So it is time to build back all those things. So in the British era, we talk about a lot of things that went wrong in the colonization. So we talk about, like, you know, they took our gold and silver and all those things. Those were minor things, like, you know, taking our gold and silver. One of the things that they did really worse to India was they let India de-urbanize. So during the British era, especially the northern India, the UP, Bihar, and all those places, have you seen any new city constructed? So in the South India, we had new cities constructed during that period. Madras was a new city. And if you think Bombay as a southern part, like, you know, geographically it's a southern part of the country. So Bombay is a new city. Calcutta is a new city. Hyderabad was a new city. Bangalore was a new city. What were the new cities in northern India? Almost nothing. In fact, even New Delhi came as a sort of an afterthought right at the end of the colonial era. So this colonial era's biggest impact on India was that they let northern India completely de-urbanize. So the great cities of the past were all decayed. They came to the nadir. So they could have taken all our gold and silver, we would have still survived. But then what they took was that they took our cities, sort of. So the whole lifeline of the Gangetic plain was mostly gone, because there was a huge de-urbanization that happened for a long time, not through deliberate means probably, but still it happened. So that is what, so to reverse that, we need to get back to what we did. But what did we do since independence? So then let's see the what our republic did. So in 1947, like, you know, if you go 70 years ago, like April 1947, these were the major cities we had over here: Calcutta, Bombay, Lahore, Madras, Delhi, Karachi, Hyderabad, Rawalpindi, Bangalore, Dhaka, Mysore. So these were among the major settlements then. If you now look at just the metropolitan cities of today, we should expect like this to go like 3, 4, 5 times, right? But actually it reduced since 1947. So the number of major cities, we have a couple of cities like Pune and Ahmedabad going into that top, but still we have not built. And in parallel, what happened to our population? In 1947, our population was about 40 crore. And we have added 80 crore more people. And how many cities we have built? We have built like really two cities. And even the second city, how much of a city we are, it's a controversy, but Chandigarh and Bhubaneswar are the only two cities we have built, and about a dozen towns. That's pretty much it, like in the 70 years of our republic, when we've added 80 crore more people. And this is one of the fundamental problems that is bringing down India. We don't have enough new cities, and that means the people are all like pushing down on the existing cities, because they are all flooding into the existing cities, making our cities really cry in desperation. Our infrastructure is screwed up. Delhi has become one of the most polluted places. It's among the most unsafe places. All those things happen because we have not created enough new cities, and we have the British era was worse for that, and in the independent era we have taken it much worse, and then we have brought to a point where our city construction, new city construction has come almost to a halt. So what we need to do is that at a crazy pace, we need 500 new cities, and if we don't build it fast enough, we are not going to become the superpower that we want to be. And this number looks this like crazy big, but during Indus Valley Civilization, we have like close to this 500 settlements, 500 sort of cities we could call it. They built it, and the Americans in about like 100-150 years, they built over 150 cities, and they are like nearly 1/4 of our population. So if they could, we could, and like, so pretty much like, you know, empowering every district collector to build a city and coordinate a city. And this city should have a lot of new properties that we want it to be. So some of these commandments for this new 10 new commandments are one for the cities. So the first central element, so our Indus Valley civilization was known for its planning cleanliness. So this is the first commandment we have to take. It is this urban filth that we have been, like, you know, we had like Swachh Bharat Mission and all those things like doing on the surface, but we have to go something fundamentally deep. So there's a fundamental idea that I've been like, you know, talking to a bunch of guys in the waste management. So Indians have the habit of throwing anyway the stuff onto the street, on our things, not putting onto the proper basket and planning. So our new cities should have this fundamental thing of like there has to be a chute for a compostable waste, and then non-compostable waste you don't need to store. It just goes down the pipe. In fact, to some extent, Indus Valley civilization already had a similar system. So you throw waste into that. If it is a compostable waste, it gets composted right there underneath your community, and then it generates part of it generates as energy that would be driving the overall process, pulling down, sucking in, and so on. And the rest of it would be manure. So that will be lot smaller than the overall compost that you put. So the volume is quite low. And that means it's also easy for the corporations to come and pick it up. And the other way would be like to, other thing is like non-compostable material that has to be compacted. Again, I have friends who have built solar-powered compactors right in the waste bins and all. So if we again compact it, we would not have this overflowing waste everywhere. And the waste collection is a very expensive process. Once we do at the community level, then all the corporations have to do was like come over when it is full, like when the sensors are full, external indication is full, and then come over and then pick it up box by box, the manure box and then the recyclable box, and then go and use it. Maybe the manure could be used right there for the community gardening and so on. So the fundamental thing we have to have is like the change the way in which we collect waste, we dispose waste, and we can both look at our past as well as the modern technologies available, how do we compost in a much more efficient way, and how do we recycle in a much more efficient way right at the locally happening, rather than trying to put in all separate baskets and then collecting it, and then once again the corporations mix it anyway and screw it up. So the first founding principle that we have to have is, how do we do an integrated waste management in our system? The second thing is, again, the fundamental thing of, so all of our cities are built next to water. Without water, we have nothing. So the core of it should be like this three-pronged approach to it, and this we can learn from Israel, especially. Israel has done all these three things amazingly well. So the first part of this water management should be the rainwater harvesting. So Jayalalitha, for all her wrongs, one of the great things she did was, like, you know, forced rainwater harvesting that improved the water tables much better. But only problem is we are sucking out even more from the groundwater. But that is a start. We have to go at much more efficient than that. The second part of it is the desalination. Already there are technologies that have been bringing down the cost so much down. So in a lot of parts of Israel, just these three approaches work for the most part: rainwater harvesting, desalination, and wastewater reclamation. Do it in a cycle. Then you don't need to be drawing from our rivers, which are already brought dry. And especially I'm from the Kaveri Delta region, and we see such a great civilization that was brought there. The Chola civilization is now in ruins. Part of it is very bad water management, and the same thing collapsed Indus Valley civilization too. Water management was something, probably they didn't screw it up deliberately, but there was a huge drought that occurred around 1500 BCE that screwed up all the civilizations of that time. Water is so important. If we screw water, we screw our civilization. So we need an integrated water management plan to not draw upon our groundwater or our river water. We need to have an integrated water management for these new cities that we are building. The third part is, they should have jobs. Like, the city has to have, and each city has to build around the core specialization, a bunch of new technologies that are coming, whether it is in space tech or robotics tech or agri-tech or fintech. Now, right now we have small startups doing that. What we need to do is at a gigantic scale. So a city has to specialize in one of two of these things. We are going to be the world's capital for health tech or the fintech or the jewelry tech or the farming tech and so on. So they have to build it at a level of specialization where world over we can get people in. And that is how it is going. We are going to be absorbing the millions who are going to be quitting farming in the next few years. So those we have to be absorbing in this drastic new cities that we are creating. And for that, each city has to have one core economic course that has to be very, very thought about, because without the economic core, there is no city. Now, but the fourth thing is, again, we have to, as we are going to build this 500 new cities, we are going to break almost every treaty that we have signed, whether it's the Paris Protocol and others, because we are going to be, if we are continuing with our existing way of energy consumption, we are going to be breaking every global warming treaty that we have, because we are going to be consuming enormous amount of carbon if we are going to be going in that mode. So that means right from the start, we have to be looking at how do we use the power of the atom. So one is already, Sun already provides us the biggest nuclear reactor we can find in our region. So first, let us use it. And Homi Bhabha talked about the three stages of the nuclear reactor long time ago. This is time for us to finally push really hard. Once we get these two, we are sort of a self-sustainable energy system, both these two things that provides us. The next thing we have to do is the healthcare part. So how do we have an integrated healthcare management system? So instead of us going to the doctors and so on, so we have to be changing the way in which works. The systems have to come towards us. Part of it is telemedicine and part of it is robots. Once the telemedicine goes to the next step, so we have been talking to a couple of pharma companies on this thing too. So how do we bring to the next step to have this preventive care, and then the health vans, and then the palliative care and so on. So we have to be looking at how do we think through this healthcare problem, because with this 500 new cities, if we don't think through a new sort of a healthcare model, we're completely screwed. We don't have enough doctors for 1.2 billion people. So we have to be thinking about how do we do this at scale? How do we do this in a different way? Because each of the things that we are doing have to be done in a different way if you're talking about 500 new cities. And then, one of the things, great things I like about the Indus Valley civilization is this great community pools, this great bar. The Egyptians, think of they have done this useless monuments called pyramids. Who needs the pyramids, by the way? Our guys, they did not build any such useless monument. They built this public baths where people go and relax. We need to have a proper city, a proper society. We need this relaxation points where the community can enjoy it together, community gardening, community pools, community grounds, where they can. It has to be a core part of the building, core part of our thinking. Again, going back to the Indus Valley civilization. And the seventh principle is streets are for people, for walking. We have slowly turned our streets into this maniac driver thing. So we have to be reclaiming the streets once again, because the streets are the core for any kind of community engagement. Right now, we have built the streets and roads in a way where it connects on its longitude, on its length, but it divides on its latitude, because we have built this dividing mechanism. We have to reclaim the street, because only the when we have the streets as something walkable where the community can work, that's when we can have all the kind of civic sense and everything going on. So we have to reclaim the streets back into that. Means changing the way our transportation systems work, pushing back on the private transportation mechanism, and that requires us to have the proper mass transportation mechanism, like the trains, the mass. So do we have space for that? People keep talking about, do we have a space for this? So the thing is, we think the cities require more things. So let's say we have to build 500 Chandigarh type cities. It could require 1.5 crore acres. It looks like a really big number. But when you look at it, what is the total size of it? 4.8 crore acres we have in Gujarat alone. If you look at the whole size of India, if you have to build this 500 new cities that is going to take 90% of the population, you're going to require 1.4 crore acres. That is about 3% of India's space. That's the level of planning we can get into. Because fundamentally, if you're looking at this village kind of settlement, all these discrete things, now we can move that into a city kind of thing where we can bring them together so that we will have extra space for play, entertainment. And that's our future. 500 new cities. Thank you.